So there comes a time in every geocacher's career, I guess, life, whatever, when the inevitable happens. Some cache that you've carefully made and hidden goes missing. So, time to hit the shop and build a new one. First thing I did, went down to the hardware store, grabbed a couple of bolts. And I clamped them up one at a time in my fancy holding device here and took at them with my hacksaw. As you might expect, hacksawing a bolt is going to take a very long time if you got a cheap crappy hacksaw like mine. So, if you got better tools, why not use them? Enter the Dremel. Now this makes fairly quick work of it. Obviously you want to keep out of the way where your safety equipment, as you can see that I'm clearly doing. But, very short time later, we have the bolt cut off. Now I'm just going to hit it with a file a couple of times to take the sharp burred edges off and make sure that the nut will go on properly. Let's go find a nut. There it is. And yeah, it goes on. Okay, on to the next step, which is center punching the cutoff side of that bolt so that the drill bit and then the following step can find the center and actually stay there. Unfortunately, I don't have a center punch, so I use a nail, which was a cheap crappy nail and bent. So I'll use the Dremel again and just cut a little X marks the spot in the middle so that my drill bit can find the center and not wander around and make evil noises and shatter and do all kinds of bad stuff. There we go. Alright, now using a fairly small drill bit, much smaller than my hole, final hole size, I'll drill down into it and make a starter hole for some progressively larger drill bits that I'll bring in later on. I've got the depth stop set on my drill press so I don't go all the way through, because I don't want to turn this into a cylinder. I want it to be turned into a hollow bolt. Alright, that one's done. Larger drill bit. And a little bit of oil in there just to keep it from sticking and keep it cool. Over with this horrendous old drill bit, because I've got all cheap drill bits around here. That doesn't really help much. But I finally made it through. There we go. Two bolts drilled out and two nuts to go with them. Now, sort through my 50-piece magnet sampler assortment from our friends at Lee Valley, who didn't sponsor me. Anyway, find a magnet of the appropriate size. What I want is something just the size of the hole, or a hair bigger preferably. And that's what this one is. Right, next step, back to the drill press. And using a step bit in this case, Unibit's one brand, this one's a cheap Chinese knockoff, I just put a little shoulder in that, just big enough for the magnet to fit in. At least I hope it's big enough for the magnet to fit in. There we go. Just like it was made for it. Kind of like it was. Right. Next, grab some methyl hydrate, 99% alcohol. I'm using it here as a cleaner to get any oil and residue off the magnets and off the nuts as well. I want the adhesive that I use to attach the magnet to get a good grip on both of them. The magnets are pretty shiny surface, so I want the best chances of it actually sticking when I pull out my 5-minute epoxy. Squirt out a generous couple of blobs and mix them together. And then kind of goop it into that shoulder that I just made with the Unibit, with the drill. Get a fairly generous amount in there. Not overkill, because I don't want it to get into the threads. But just enough to fill that, so that when I snap the magnet in there, there'll be a nice smooth little fillet on the inside, which will act like a weatherproofing gasket. And there, oh, not quite fit in, so give it a little tappy tap. Oh, stupid. Don't use a metal tool. Use a wooden tool. There we go. Wipe up the little spillage. And repeat with the second one. Alright, next I'll grab some black paint. This happens to be Tester's flat black model paint, but you can use whatever you got handy. And I'm going to just throw that bolt on a screwdriver for a handle so I don't get too much paint on my fingers. And get a fairly good coverage on there. I'm only going to paint one of the bolts black. I'm going to leave the other one sort of the natural metal color. The black one's the one I'm going to use because my spot is a black painted piece of metal. I'll save the other one for another place. After the black paint's dry, I come back on both bolts and on the nuts as well with some rust red colored craft paint from the dollar store. And just what I happen to have. You could use anything because there's another step later that's going to weatherproof it. So I'm just smudging that all over everything. I want to get it down into the grooves and whatnot. Because now I sort of pat it off and get it off the high spots. I don't want it to look like it's a painted red bolt. I want it to look like it's just got rust that's settled into the grooves and a thin layer on the surface. Excuse the horrible editing. Pretend that didn't happen. Okay. Now pull out a spray can of Dull Coat, Tester's brand Dull Coat. Again, doesn't matter what brand or anything. This is a clear lacquer with a matte finish. And being a lacquer, it's going to protect the paint from the weather. So I really could have used anything. I didn't need to use the Tester's. I could have used craft paint or whatever I happen to have kicking around. So now let that dry for a day or two. And here's what they look like. There's the silver or natural one, and there's the black one. At this point, I discovered that I forgot to clean all the filings out when I was finished drilling. So, give that a little swab in there. It's messier than I thought. I also forgot to take the oil out from when I was drilling too. So, give it a good solid cleaning. Don't want the oil getting onto the log sheet. Speaking of which, log sheet. These are just some that I downloaded off the internet and printed out. There's a bunch of different sizes available. I'll put a link down in the description. What I'm doing here is putting a little piece of clear tape on. It does a couple of things. It just firms up the paper, thickens it up so it's more durable. It protects it a little bit from moisture. And just protects it from tearing and whatnot on the outside of the coil. Protects it from getting shredded against the metal of the bolt as well. And when I'm doing this for these nano caches, I use a little flag of tape off to the side, which you'll see later acts as a bit of a handle for extracting it. Now roll them up nice and tight, and there it is. And there you can see the brilliance of my little tape handle. And yes, it's going to get squashed down a little bit. But it's a couple of layers of tape, it's plastic, it's going to bounce right back. See, it's a little crumpled, but nice little handle for grabbing it out. Beautiful. Right, let's go and install this. And here is the ground zero for my cache. I'm not going to spend too much time here because I'm trying to be a little bit surreptitious. As you do when you're at ground zero with geocache, but there it is. Oh, nothing suspicious, just the bolt that's holding down the bench top, much like this one at the front. There we go, the only thing left. Onto the geocaching website and re-enable my cache. Thanks for watching, hope you enjoyed. I'll talk to you later.